And I'll share the screen.
Thanks, Shelley. Hey, good morning, everyone, and Happy New Year. We're really thrilled to have you join us. My name is Ingrid Busada, and I am with the North Carolina Division of Public Health. I'm an injury prevention consultant and the manager of the core state injury prevention program there. I'm also the chair of the Southeastern and Southwestern Injury Prevention Network, and I'm just thrilled to see so many of you all here. Appreciate everyone who's putting their camera on. I understand that it's not feasible for everyone, but if it is feasible and you're comfortable with it, we'd love to have you turn your camera on so we can try to build community today. So this is our first virtual meeting for 2024. And as I said, we're really thrilled to have so many of you on. Before we get started, I'd love to go through a few technical tips. If you could, please, in your window that either has your picture or your video or your name, if you're not on camera, if you could rename yourself with your name and your state, that would help us get to know each other a little bit better. You can do that by going to the three dots at the top right and scrolling down on that menu, and you'll see rename there, and it's pretty self-explanatory. Also join the audio via your computer if at all possible. Of course, as always, you all know this. Mute yourself if you're not talking, state your name when you do talk. And if someone else is speaking, please use the raise your hand function and wait to be called on by the facilitator at that time. So we are the Southeastern and Southwestern Regional Injury Prevention Network. And the network serves as a hub for the network serves as a resource hub for sharing, for capacity building and partnership brokering for injury and violence prevention professionals. And we are home to professionals and researchers across all 13 states in the Southeastern and Southwestern network. I did jump ahead just a moment, so if you could go back and go into the chat and put your name, your organization, and answer one of the two questions. You don't have to do both. Just what is your favorite winter activity, or what is your hope for 2024? As a network, one of the things that we really do focus on is getting to know others who are doing similar work so that we are able to call on each other when we want support or have questions, want to brainstorm. So we really do want to have a chance to kind of get to know each other as individuals as we move forward. I'm seeing some of y'all filling it in. Okay, so please continue to do that. If you missed the note in the very beginning, we are recording this meeting so that others who weren't able to join us can go back and view it. And also, if you wanted to go back and view something that you missed, please feel free to do so. We will have that on the web. So let's get started with a little bit about the network. We do have a lot of new members, and not everyone knows our history, who we are, what we do. So I wanted to just spend a few minutes going over some of that. We are growing very rapidly, which is wonderful. And there are over 300 of us now who are part of this network, which is also wonderful to see. We're going to have a little bit of time at the end of this for some questions, so please jot those down and hold on to them until we get to the end. I just have a few slides. First off, just a little bit of history. The network actually started in 1988 as the Southeastern Regional Injury Control Network. That was Saracen for short. And it was originally established by the University of North Carolina Injury Prevention Research Center, along with the University of Alabama Injury Control Research Center. And the purpose at the time was to convene state health departments and injury control research centers across the region. It was a little more of a narrow focus than it is today. The Northeast also had a similar network at the time, but that one was focused primarily on child safety. Next slide. In 2012, through the Core State Injury and Violence Prevention Program funding, the CDC began funding just one state health department in each of the five regions across the US to coordinate the regional network of their area. And some of you may recall hearing reference to RNLs, or regional network leaders, or RNCOs, which would be regional network coordinating organizations at the time. The CDC funded those networks and named them following the Health and Human Services region, which means that the previous eight Saracen states in region four, and that would be Kentucky, North Carolina, South Carolina, Tennessee, Florida, Georgia, Alabama, and Mississippi, were combined with region six states, which would be New Mexico, Texas, Oklahoma, Arkansas, and Louisiana. So that now our network is comprised of 13 overall states. And we formed the Southeastern and Southwestern Injury Prevention Network in 2012. From that time until 2021, the North Carolina Division of Public Health collaborated with the University of North Carolina Injury Prevention Research Center to facilitate the network and to enhance collaboration among injury and violence prevention organizations, as well as to share scientific evidence and programmatic best practices. Next slide. In 2021, CDC made the decision to transfer the facilitation of the five regional networks to Safe States Alliance. And that included all of the administrative duties like scheduling meetings, providing virtual platforms, communications, et cetera. Establishing and facilitating the Regional Networks Guidance Council, which oversees or provides support, not really oversees, but provides support to all five of the regional networks, and also coordinating regional activities like learning opportunities, virtual and in-person meetings, and regional or cross-region projects. And so that would, for example, include helping to coordinate this meeting. The network leadership team would like to thank Shelley Stevens-Stidham. Hey, Shelley, for all of your hard work and time putting together a lot of the logistics for this meeting, as well as the slides, and just really appreciate everything you've done. Safe States and Shelley have and continue to be just incredible partners for us. Next slide. For those who don't know, Safe States Alliance was established in 1993, and it is a national nonprofit organization and a professional association whose mission is to strengthen the practice of injury and violence prevention. Check out their website if you're not familiar with them. There's a lot of amazing resources there. And then currently there are more than 300 members, as I mentioned, of our Southeastern and Southwestern Injury Prevention Network. We have members who represent state and local health departments, hospitals, tribal programs, universities, military and civilian staff, as well as community organizations and some federal partners. Membership is free, and it is open to anyone who's an injury and violence prevention professional in our region who's interested in getting to know others who are doing similar work. So we do encourage you to share information about the network with your colleagues or your partners who may not know about us yet. Next slide. We also have an elected leadership team that meets monthly to plan activities for the year. But the network is guided by you all, the membership, and you provide feedback to the leadership team and Safe State staff, and that is then just, and the leadership team and Safe State staff, like Shelley, provide information dissemination and learning opportunities back to the members. Elections for the leadership team are held every fall. So if you are interested in serving on the team, please do connect with any one of us. And you'll see our pictures in just a moment. And we are happy to talk to you about it. You can also talk to Shelley Stevens-Stidham. Her email is at the very end of today's presentation. And I'd like to thank the rest of the leadership team for all that you do to help make events such as this meeting possible. And you can see us on here. I am the chair. Emma Kennedy is our vice chair, and Rachel Wexler serves as our immediate past chair. We also have a secretary with Stacy Pachinka and two members at large. That would be Christopher Clark and Kristen Sanderson. And so now I would like to turn this over to Emma Kennedy, Vice Chair and Director of the Division of Injury and Substance Abuse Prevention for the South Carolina Department of Health and Environmental Control. She's also the Vice Chair of the Southeastern and Southwestern Network, as I mentioned, and she is going to discuss some of our network accomplishments during 2023. So turning it over, Emma.
Thank you, Ingrid. Good morning, everyone. So we were fortunate to hold two in-person meetings in 2023. The New Mexico Department of Health hosted us in Santa Fe, New Mexico. We learned about all the efforts from the grantees, and of course, were able to participate in the ever-important networking. We also were able to enjoy some delicious Mexican food. It was my first time trying sopapillas, and they are delicious. I'll have to see if I can get those somewhere in South Carolina. So next slide. In September 2023, we had an in-person meeting in conjunction with the annual Safe States Conference in Denver, Colorado. We were able to hold a virtual meeting in February, and we had hosted three coffee chats throughout the year 2023. Also in 2023, the network voted to revise the bylaws, and we wanted to extend a thank you to Terry Love in Tennessee, Marissa Rodriguez in Texas, and Janice White in North Carolina for serving on the Structural Review Committee and making those recommendations and revisions. So if there aren't any questions about that, I'm going to kick it back to Ingrid, and she's going to tell you about the results of the 2023 year-end member survey.
Thanks, Emma. And actually, I do want to pause for just a second. Does anyone have any questions about anything I've already presented or about some of the achievements that Emma just talked about? We have just a couple minutes to go through that if you have any. Okay. So hearing none, let's talk a little bit about the survey. So you may recall that a link to complete an end of the year survey was sent out in November of last year. And the purpose of that survey is really to help us create a regional network that serves your interests and your needs. And also hear more about what it is that we can improve. Unfortunately, we did get a low response rate, but we did get 25 responses, which is fantastic, and definitely appreciate the folks who took some time to give us that feedback and input. We think that we can use these results, and we did talk about and think through how we can improve and do better to serve our network. So about a third of the respondents that we had were from trauma centers or hospitals. Also about a third were from state health departments, and the rest of the respondents were kind of split up between local health departments, university affiliates, military, and nonprofit organizations. Less than 50% of the respondents reported that they participate often or occasionally. Next slide. When we asked about why they participate, the top two responses were gaining new knowledge or skills and making connections with practitioners in the region, which is, of course, two of our main purposes. So that's great that people are seeing that as a value in the network. Some other reasons people participate are to share resources, hear the latest on data related to injury prevention, also how to improve their programs, their health equity efforts, their evaluation efforts, make connections with researchers, collaborate with others, both researchers and practitioners. Next slide. As a result of participating, about three quarters of the respondents said that they did learn something new, and about that many also plan to attend future meetings. Same number gained a new perspective by participating. A little over half did make at least one new connection. And then others did find some new resources or gained a better understanding of health equity. Next slide. When we asked about the other types of opportunities or knowledge that people were looking for, what kind of topics they want discussed, there were a wide variety of responses. And I'll give you just a moment to look at those, but I wanted to highlight a couple. You know, there are many states in the region who receive core SIP funding. Not all of us do, but there is some interest in core SIP specific topics. And those same topics are of interest to others, like traumatic brain injury and transportation and ACEs. So that is one area. Also, more around shared risk and protective factors and how to engage policymakers. More information about things that we did present last year, like artificial intelligence and social network mapping. And we took that to heart. And actually, that is our main presentation today, is on artificial intelligence. And we will learn more about social network mapping later, later on. Not today. And finally, a little more about ways that we can leverage our strengths or build partnerships, especially when there isn't funding, as we all do kind of struggle with that. Next slide. And then finally, what recommendations do people have? There was a request for a directory with contact info and roles of all other network members, which is definitely something that's actively being discussed right now. More breakout sessions and interactive activities, ways to highlight member achievements and celebrate successes. And I think that's a fantastic thing that we are going to try to incorporate moving forward. And then also having two or more states share information or present on a similar topic. So I'll give you just a sec to look at the rest of those. Okay, does anyone have any questions about anything regarding the survey or some of those results? I'll give it just a sec. Okay, so we are now going to turn over to our presentation. We're very pleased to have Tracy Meehan with us today. Tracy will be providing us information on AI or artificial intelligence, as well as ChatGPT and many other platforms that have been developed in the last few years. Tracy is the Director of Research Translation and Communications for the Center for Injury Research and Policy at Nationwide Children's Hospital in Columbus, Ohio. She also serves as an AI content expert for the Institute for Healthcare Advancement. And some of you may have already heard Tracy present on this subject in other venues. And we are just thrilled to have her here with us today to shed some more light on this very important topic and how it can help support some of the work that we are all doing in injury and violence prevention. So Tracy, take it away.
All right. Thank you. I'm excited to have the opportunity to speak with you all today. I do have a lot to go over, so I'm going to go ahead and just jump right in here. Let me share my screen. Okay. So today we're going to talk about AI and public health, and there's a lot of concern. Some people are really concerned and don't want to jump into AI at all, and other people are really excited about the possibilities. And I understand both points of view. And so we're going to go over a little why we should think about it and what guardrails maybe we need to put in place. So many of us got introduced to AI and ChatGPT when all of a sudden in November, of last, I guess 2 years ago at this point, we're in January now. All of a sudden we started hearing all these reports about students using this new program called ChatGPT to cheat. That's how many of us heard about AI and how it was really going to impact us. And then we started hearing all these stories about AI passing medical exams and news sites using AI to write articles and not turning out well, and scientists using it to write, and all kinds of different crazy things. So a lot of us, that's kind of how we started hearing about it. But I do want to say there are a lot of really cool things that can be done with AI. And in reality, it's actually been with us for longer than people realize. And it's doing everything from creating images and video and sound to writing almost anything. You can chat with customers, analyze data, review x-rays, design buildings and landscapes, help with research, which we're going to talk a little bit about, and grant writing, which that looks like. You can even use it to plan a menu from what you have in your cupboard. So it can do a lot of amazing things. But there are some limitations and risks that we need to be aware of when we do think about how to responsibly use them. So that's kind of what we're going to talk about a little bit today. Before we go into it, really, I just want to also kind of point out that the speed of change in the AI spaces is unlike anything we are used to in public health and academia. It is crazy fast how quickly things change. For the most part, it doesn't matter if you're using it kind of entry level, but it goes really, really quickly. And the conversations that we need to have kind of now when we're still at the beginning can have big impact on how we do things. And just a little kind of snippet of what that looks like. One of the measurements that people use to kind of show success of programs is how long it takes them to reach 1 million users. And I want to show some examples. So Netflix, it took over 1,200 days to reach 1 million users, which is about 3.5 years. Airbnb, it took 2.5 years. Facebook took 10 months. Spotify took 5 months. Instagram took 2.5 months. The iPhone took 74 days. For ChatGPT to reach 1 million users, it took 5 days. And there were over 100 million users in less than 6 months, and more than 180 million at a year. So as I noted, it goes fast. And then even more interestingly, in early November of 2024, OpenAI, which is the company that started ChatGPT, announced the ability to create custom GPT models. And within days, there were hundreds available and a marketplace where people could sell them or sell access to them. And we'll talk about why that's significant a little bit later. So today, what are we going to talk about? We're going to talk about exactly what large language models are, or LLMs as they're called, and how they work. Kind of why it's coming into place now, limitations, some ethical questions, some potential risks. Want to set it up all that way. And then we're going to talk about what can it do and kind of what's coming. So in order to really understand what we can do with these programs, we really kind of need to understand what they are and how they're created. So LLM stands for Large Language Model. And the one most people have heard of is the AI chatbot built by OpenAI called ChatGPT. And right now, these programs can be used to, you can ask it questions, you can have it write things for you, you can write code. Now there's video, and it can read PDFs and all kinds of different things. ChatGPT is one, and it's the one that most people have heard of, but there are many others like Llama and Orca and Bloom and Grok, and they're all similar, but each of them is unique, and we're going to talk about why that matters. Also, GPT, just for the background, stands for Generative Pre-Training Transformer. So this means a generative model means that it can make new things, like writing a story or a sentence. Pre-training means that it was shown a lot of examples before it started working with you. And the transformer is a special kind of computer program that helps the model understand what words mean and how they're related to each other. So think of it being like a teacher that shows you a whole bunch of books and stories and then asks you to write your own. GPT is like that. It's trained on a lot of examples and now is ready to help you write. So how do they actually work? There's a perception that these programs are this like you ask it a question, and then there's this robot brain in the background, and it's like going behind the curtain and asking your question. It does research on the best way to find the answer, and then it answers the question for you. But that's not really exactly how it works. So this is dramatic oversimplification here, but I just wanted to kind of give you an example of how it works. So you start with picking some source materials, and then you feed it into a program. And then there's a complicated statistical model that's developed to help the chatbot be able to use the source materials to develop answers for questions that people have. And then the trainers go back and ask the model questions, and they tweak the statistical model to help their program learn when it's getting the answers right and how to make the model better. So what goes into these models? And this is really important. Each program, that I mentioned, ChatGPT, Llama, Orca, all of those different ones, they use different source materials, and they're all proprietary at this point. So we don't actually know exactly what's being fed into them. What we do know is that they, for ChatGPT, for instance, they have said we use some combination of web crawls, which is they use the common crawl, which crawls the web and indexes it. They use links on Reddit. They use books, which is some combination of published and unpublished novels. And but it's unclear which ones. They are using English language Wikipedia. And importantly, right now, at least for ChatGPT, all of the source materials they used to train the program were published before 2021. And you'll see why that matters here in a minute. So in terms of the training, what the training is doing is it helps teach the model patterns about how to put words and sentences together in a way that is most likely to occur in human speech. Right. So what they're actually doing, they're not answering your question. They're looking at the words, the sentence you put in, and creating an answer based on predicting what the next logical words should be. Context matters in these. They are trained, but they have to be able to think about, if you ask the question, what are bats made of? They need to know whether you which kind of bat you mean. Right. And they also need to be able to pick up on emotional tone. So really, again, oversimplification, but what these really are, it's kind of a version of the predictive text that we already know. So like when you type in a question on Google, it starts to predict for you what you might be asking. Or on the right-hand side, there's the screen of, this is your phone. If you're texting, it puts words at the bottom for you of what it thinks you might be doing next, right? This is a version, a very oversimplified version of what these models are doing. So why does this matter? We think that there's a robot doing research for us, this perception of intelligence, right? What is really happening is there's a statistical model guesstimating what the best combination of words or phrases would be to most likely deliver an answer based on the words you used in your question. And why this matters is it can lead to kind of, quote, lies or mistruths, because it's not really thinking of necessarily about what it's spitting out. It's putting words together based on what it was trained on. So it can put out things that sound really real, but aren't. And this is true even if you ask it for citations. There are stories of it creating journal names which sound right, but aren't real journals, even journal articles that aren't real. So something you have to be really aware of and think about. So what are some of the limitations and risks? We've started to hint about this a little bit, but it's only as good as what you put into the model. So the information that you've put in there, it may have stereotypes in the data that it was trained on. There may be biases. There may be misinformation in there. There's even selection bias. What did you use to train it on and what was left out? And then again, this all of the information is before 2021, and people don't always realize that. And this is for ChatGPT specifically. Some of the newer models that'll be coming out will be trained on newer data. But again, it's hard for us to know exactly yet what that is. There's also trainer limitations. everyone, no matter who they are, sees the world through their own unique perspective based on their lived experiences. No matter how hard you try, you're going to bring your biases with you. So we need to make sure that when these companies are training models, or when we're training models, if we're creating our own, that we have a variety of voices and perspectives at the table. You know, and this is true even in what the trainer's speech and language patterns that they're comfortable with, or what they think is a good answer to a question, right? And so what does this look like? This is just one example. This is a visual example, but it gets the point across. So the prompt was put in a wall on a royal castle. There are two paintings on the wall. The one on the left is a detailed oil painting of the royal raccoon king. The one on the right is a detailed oil painting of the royal raccoon queen. Given only those directions, to look royal, the raccoons are wearing Western-style royal outfits. This can be, you know, this happens with text as well, and they can be subtle biases that can go unnoticed, and they're built into the program based on the who is training them. And it's not intentional. They just don't maybe necessarily think about, oh, there may be other perspectives, right? So it's why it's important for us to be aware of that and think about what we may be getting. Also, I should note, I do try and put in, when I created images using different programs, you will see a little note on there as well. Okay, the output is also limited. There, as we mentioned, it can have biased content if it's based on, you know, feedback from biased content that was put into it. It is also not original because it's being based off of content from somewhere else. It can have plausible sounding but incorrect information, or the top of that, harmful instructions. I was testing it out, and I asked it to create some recommendations on carbon monoxide detectors and smoke alarms and where you should put them in your home. The content that it put out sounded really good, but it was wrong. And if you don't know that, and you don't know what the recommendations are, you can be putting out wrong information and not even realizing it. It does also tend to repeat phrases and sometimes can be nonsensical. So we have to be cautious about that. And with the bias content, we can be perpetuating health disparities without realizing that we're doing it if we're not thoughtful about our review. We've also already had some companies starting to use it in controversial ways. There was an article about this one company who used AI for a mental health experiment without letting their patients know. So Rob Morris here talked about, we provided mental health support to about 4,000 people using ChatGPT-3, and here's what happened. And they didn't tell their patients they were doing it. So it kind of looked like this. So it was an online version, and people were getting guidance about their mental health from ChatGPT. And they did find that the messages were rated significantly higher than those written by humans. And the response times went down 50%. Those are good things, right? But they pulled it from their platform because once people learned the messages were co-created by a machine, it didn't work. And they said simulated empathy feels weird, right? So, you know, something for us to think about and being aware of. There's also ethical questions that come along with this. You know, we've talked about the source data. Where does it come from? Remember, all the data scraped from other people's work and is used without their permission. So this is true of text, but it's also true of artwork, photography, music, all used to create the digital images and digital music. And the artists and musicians and people who write text are starting to not feel so good about that. There's also examples of it spitting content out word for word and not referencing or citing it. So if, you know, I wrote a blog post that I put a lot of time into and ChatGPT is spitting it out as if it's something new and somebody else uses that, that doesn't feel really good. And that's copyright infringement potentially, right? So what does that look like? And we have writers and creative people who are fearing losing their jobs to a program that stole their work. And we're starting to see some companies lay people off because they think they can do it with AI better. So just thinking about that is really important. Text, artwork, photography, music, that's all been talked about a little bit, but one thing that's just starting to come to light is there are companies that are using people's biometric data to train programs, even when we haven't, you know, I haven't given anybody permission to use my biometric data, and yet it's being used to train these programs. So being aware of and thinking about that will be really important. There's also questions of responsibility. So who's responsible for AI mistakes and errors? Is it me because I used it and didn't check it? Is it OpenAI because they didn't feed the information incorrectly or train the program? Who knows? And where it really starts to become an issue is things like self-driving cars. Who's at fault? Is it the car? Is it the programming? Is it the person driving? The people walking or coming the other way? We don't, you know, there's a lot of questions. And then even deciding the line where plagiarism is and when these programs can be used and how we should disclose whether or not we're using them. There is also a question of inequality. The costs for some of these programs price people out of being able to use them. So who will be able to use them and who won't? How will the wealth created by these programs be distributed? The amount of money that will be made using these programs will be staggering, is already starting to have an impact in the economy. So what does that look like and how does that matter? And then who's going to lose their jobs to these programs? It will be differential. Different people will lose their jobs. So thinking about that. I've already talked about the biases being entered into the system, but there are also other types of biases. So there are some cool programs that are being used in the healthcare setting and public health, but we need to be careful that we're not, that we aren't building biases into the program from the start to perpetuate what's already happening in many of those spaces. And a couple examples here, there's software that's being used to detect future crime. And it's been shown to have a bias against Black people. There's facial recognition programs that have a harder time recognizing non-white people. And what does that look like? There's even bias in how the programs are being used. So things we need to, again, be aware of. We all are very much familiar with mis and disinformation at this point. And hackers are going to be able to figure out how to infiltrate these systems. So what protections are in place? We're still trying to figure that out. The companies that create these are still trying to figure that out. And then we know already that that type of information may be in their original data sources, therefore being trained into the model. So what is going to be done to stop that? Not a lot of discussion about that is happening in these spaces right now. When we do start to use it, which I do think we should, we need to have some caution. So one thing that I did is I started to do some tests. We're going to get some examples here. I'm not going to go through this word for word, but I decided to test it. And I asked ChatGPT to write a 3-paragraph bio for me that focuses on injury prevention and health communication, because that's what I do. And let me just tell you, it makes me sound awesome. And a lot of the information here is truth adjacent, but not actually true. And so the red lines are what what's underlined here is what's not actually true. So it says I have a Bachelor of Arts degree in communication from the University of Pennsylvania, which is not true. I have a Bachelor of Arts degree in psychology from Princeton and a Master of Arts degree in communication from the University of Pennsylvania. So close, right? And it says I have a Master of Public Health degree in health behavior and education from North Carolina. Nope, don't have that. I'm working on a PhD in health behavior and health promotion from Ohio State, but not exactly, right? It even says that I'm the director of the National Center for Injury Prevention and Control at the CDC. Great promotion for me, but not actually true. I work with the CDC. I've worked with the director, but I definitely am not the director. It tells me that I've been a consultant for World Health Organization and United Nations. I have grants from Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. All of those, I work with those groups. I have, you know, worked on grants from Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, but I don't have this particular one, right? So just got to be really careful of, because it sounds real and it sounds like it could be true. And you know, I mentioned this already with the example of the carbon monoxide, but the content can sound good, but it's factually incorrect. And when is that going to matter for us, right? It's particularly dangerous if you're in public health or healthcare, and if you're not paying close attention, or you're having maybe somebody work on this content that maybe doesn't know the area as well, the recommendations or what we say to people based on ChatGPT or other programs like this could actually lead to harm if we're not careful. So we have to really be careful if we're going to use these, and you have to fact check everything. I also talked a little bit about what is called hallucination. So this is defined as a confident response by an AI that does not seem to be justified by its training data. So at the bottom, the example I've already shared is the fake citation. It makes up article names and journals that don't exist. Scary in and of itself, but to me, a little more scary is inaccurate data. So the example I put here is a chatbot with no knowledge of the number of firearm-related injuries in the United States in 2023, because remember, it was trained only up until 2021. It might pick a number at random that it considers to be plausible based on its training data, and then use that number repeatedly with no awareness that it made up the number and that it's not correct. And if somebody that's not paying attention starts using a number like that, then that those numbers are going to start to get out in the world, and it's based on nothing, right? So we have to be really careful. Again, this is an example of an image I created using DALL-E with a prompt. So I just want to acknowledge that I am using those programs in here, these images in here, and they can be helpful. Really, really, really important. If you do start using these, remember that anything you put into the program becomes part of their learning and can be accessed by anyone. So do not put anything in there that you don't want out in the world. This is really true about patient data or PHI, but it's also true. Samsung actually banned their employees from using ChatGPT because it writes code. When there was, it had proprietary code that somebody was put in to try and tweak and make it do something else. And it got put out somewhere out in the real world to somebody that was not a Samsung employee. So got to be really careful about this. For a short amount of time, Italy banned ChatGPT. It is now being used again, but you got to be really careful. You have to know that that stuff is going out there. So even the creators don't always understand how these work. And I wanted to put this in here because people don't, I think it's important. So even the people who are training these programs, here's just a couple examples. What they thought they were training it to do was reduce the number of sorting errors in a list. What the AI program actually did was deleted the list. And that meant there were technically no more errors, right? Another example, they asked it to play Tetris and not lose. So the computer started playing the game and then hit the pause button on the game, so it never finished, which meant it technically didn't lose. So we don't always know what's happening, right? And those aren't, you know, horrible things. But then if you skip down to the next two, it asked it to identify tumors and their size. And the way they trained it, they fed a bunch of x-rays into it. And what they realized is the training information they used all had tumors, and they had a little ruler next to the tumor because that's how the medical professionals were measuring the tumor. And what they realized was it was actually training itself to identify images with the rulers. So if somebody actually fed an x-ray into it and was trying to figure out, is there a tumor in here? And they hadn't used the ruler to see if this is the thing, it's going to miss the fact that there was a tumor. And this is important because healthcare professionals are starting to use it for stuff like this. So really making sure that the programs are being trained and used correctly is important. And then the last one, identifying people more likely to commit a crime by looking at previous arrest trends. We know that people that are more likely to be arrested are not necessarily those more likely to commit a crime. They're more likely to be arrested. Difference, right? So we need to think about that kind of stuff. There's also litigation that's starting to happen. Authors, artists, and others are filing lawsuits against these programs for using their data to train without their permission. There's a tutoring firm that had its first lawsuit. So it was a China-based tutoring company. And they have agreed to settle a U.S. government agency's lawsuit claiming that it used hiring software powered by artificial intelligence to illegally screen out women age 55 or older and men who are 60 or older. That was built into the screening program, and the company that used it didn't realize that that was already built in. This is important because at least 85% of large companies in the U.S. are using AI for some aspects of employment, which can be really scary if they don't realize that that's built into the code of the program that they're using. Okay, so I've scared you a bunch potentially, but now I want to talk about what can it do. So already, we've showed examples of the types of things it is being used for, right? But it's also used in other places. So if you have any of the voice activated assistants, that's using AI. Amazon is a prime example of this. Amazon will give you, you look at one thing and it will give you suggestions for what you might be looking for, gift ideas inspired by your shopping history, items chosen for you, more items to explore. You might also like buy again, right? They're really good at this. Another example is Netflix. Came across this over the holidays last year. My husband and I were watching a program and we had been watching it on his account, but we were signed into my account and we're trying to find it. And we realized the little thumbnail that came up was different on my account versus his account. On my account, it was showing the cute male actors. And on his account, it was showing the cute female actors, same program, which really got me. I was like, wow, they are really deep in this, right? It was kind of surprising. And then we've even started to see things like Spotify. I use Spotify to listen to my music, and now they're having custom DJs that analyze what you listen to and like, and will create playlists just for you based on your music. So what are some of the things that we can do in our field? We can use it to save time. We can change the way we do lit reviews. We can create personalized interactive learning materials, improve grant research, writing, and communication, and increase representation. These are just a few examples, but some things I wanted to talk about. In case you haven't used it, I thought I would give a little example here so you can see what it looks like. This is a slightly older version of ChatGPT, but it works the same way. So you pull up the home screen and you type in a question. And here we're asking it, what are the most common questions people ask ChatGPT? This is real time. I recorded this real time. And this is how fast it comes up. So it can come up really quickly with answers to the questions. Like, it surprises me how fast it works in many of these cases. So what are some examples? So we can use it to do things like write repetitive writing tasks. You can write letters to insurance companies. This is an example of, I asked it to write a letter to the drug manufacturer of Tibsovo, asking them to grant a patient access to the medication at no cost due to their financial hardship. So it spit it out in seconds and you have a base, right? Instead of me taking all the time to write something, it comes out like that and I can have something to work with. You can use it to generate first drafts. You can use it to create patient-friendly descriptions of procedures on post-procedure instructions. You can even sort of use it for health literacy. So you can ask it to explain some concept at a middle school level or an eighth grade reading level, which we like to do a lot in our field, right? It's not perfect, but it'll get you a lot closer. We've even seen examples of it improving patient communication. So there was a study where researchers looked at healthcare clients and found that patients preferred AI-generated messages for quality and empathy over those from healthcare providers. So this could help our doctor-patient communications, right? As long as we've already seen some cautions, we have to let them know that we're doing this and what that looks like. We can also help it to organize trainings. So for trainings like this, I can ask it to create 10 catchy titles for a talk. I can ask it to create a description for a webinar titled you know, one of the names I picked from there. I can write three learning objectives for participants that attend this webinar. I can create an outline for a 45-minute talk on the benefits and risks of this. All great. I will say, as you'll hear me say this again, it's great for structure and drafts. You really kind of need to know what you want to do ahead of time. I write all of my stuff down that I think first, and then I use it kind of as a, did I miss anything? Or did it have any ideas that maybe I didn't think of? I wouldn't use it directly word for word, or, you know, use everything as it comes out. I mentioned that you can use it to aid in comprehension. So this is an example I wrote in, explain how to properly wear a bicycle helmet to an 8-year-old. And it put out some content it was actually pretty good, right? Not too long, but I wanted to see what it could do. So wanted to point this out, at least on ChatGPT, it looks a little different on every program. One of the things you agree to when you sign up to use these programs is right up front, and if you're not reading, you won't catch this because not everybody reads all of what you're agreeing to when you sign up for things. You agree that you allow it to use your data for training. So it's going to use it anyway. But they're asking, at least right now, for you to say thumbs up, thumbs down, or give me notes. And some people do this, some people don't. But if you do that, you can say, you know what, thumbs down. That's not actually what I wanted. Let's try again. And I said, rewrite the answer using fewer complex words. And it rewrote it. And now it's only a couple sentences long. And it's actually not too bad. So I wanted to point out a couple of things there. I didn't have to ask the question again. It's iterative. So you ask it a question, and then I said, rewrite the answer. I didn't have to start from scratch again. So it builds on things, which is pretty cool. And then, you know, it can work on that, and you can see what it comes out with. So kind of interesting. Okay. The other thing I've seen people start to do use it for is helping people understand existing health disparities, or at least how they're perceived. Again, big caveat here, this is not going to be all inclusive, and it may have some errors, but it could be a good way to at least to get a conversation started, keeping in mind the fact that there may be biases and stereotypes that were in the program, right? But we were doing some messaging on drowning among children. And so I asked it, what are the health disparities related to drowning among children? And it came up with some good ones: access to swimming lessons, access to safe swimming areas, children with disabilities, language barriers, socioeconomic status, race and ethnicity. So it actually came up with a good start for our conversation. You can also use it for ideas about how to talk about and share research. So you can copy and paste, depending on which version and which program you're using. Some programs you can upload whole PDFs and ask it to work. Some you have to do it in bits and pieces. So this is an example if you copied and pasted a certain section. I put the discussion section in here of an article that we had done years ago on golf cart related injuries and asked it to summarize what the main points of the article were. And it came up with this. Not perfect, but a good place to start and pretty decent. And then I kind of went with this a little more. I asked it to explain the findings to me like I was 10. Again, did a pretty decent job. And then I asked it to create 5 Twitter posts based off the study, and it came up with some ideas. And then I asked it to write a script for a doctor to talk to a parent of a young child about the findings from the study. And it gave me word for word an example of what that might look like. I also asked it to write a letter to a golf cart manufacturer asking them to improve their golf cart designs based on the finding of the research. And it did a pretty good job with that as well. So as you can see, you can actually get it to do some really interesting things. Even if you don't use the end product all the way, it can be a good place for you to start and cut a lot of your work out, right? You're starting with a draft instead of starting from scratch. If you use it for lit reviews, there are different programs out there that are starting to be really cool. There's a bunch of programs now. Some of the better ones I've seen initially are called Elicit, Scholarcy, and Cite. What I have on the side here is a video of it going through and doing a lit review on a certain type of drug for reducing hair loss in women. And as you can see, it pulls in not only are the articles, but takeaways from the articles. It puts PDFs in there. It'll tell you what year, how many citations it has, how many number of participants. You can ask it to include dose and population characteristics, how long the study was. It can do some really cool things. If you do a lot of lit reviews, I definitely would recommend playing around with some of these programs if you can, and you can personalize what you want in the table. So kind of summary here. Absolutely. I think that AI is here to stay. It's going to help us do some pretty cool things, but we need to make sure we have what AI people are calling human in the loop. We need to always have a human that's reviewing the content that comes out, checking for all of these things we've talked about. We need to be thoughtful about the programs that we use and make sure we understand how they're built and what's going into it. And like with the example of the employment, what they're screening for and what they're screening out. We need to think about, know how they're being trained, and we need to know what we're asking them to do. So we can use AI to help create our structure while we create the content that goes into the structure. I've also heard it thinking of AI like an intern or a co-pilot. It can get you 70% of the way, but you need to bring your voice and your expertise to anything that you're creating with it. You have to assume that the data is wrong and fact check everything before you put anything out. And we need to have a variety of people with different backgrounds to have a seat at the table. So I've talked a lot about text. I want to talk a little bit about images. Some of the bigger companies that people are using, I just realized. So DALL-E is now up to three, maybe four. Midjourney and Crayon are some of the programs that people know about. And these you can access on your own, some paid, some not paid. But they're also starting to be used in programs like Canva, which is a graphic design program many people use, Vyond, which creates videos, and even Microsoft now is incorporating AI into many of their programs, and you'll start to see it more. So they're starting to come up with examples. Like this is an example of an AI-created image of Vermeer's painting Girl with a Pearl Earring. That's, if you know the painting, this is actually pretty good representation. But there are some limitations. So this is an example of one that was created using Biden. You can definitely tell that it's him, but if you look at his hands, they definitely look weird, and it's, you know, kind of, you can tell that it's him, but it definitely looks off. So how can we use this? I do a lot of health communications, and one of the constant battles for me is finding no or low cost photos that show correct health behaviors and show diversity. We hardly ever have a budget for a photo shoot, and so I'm limited with what I can find online for what I can use in my messaging. These programs might be able to help us address some of those with a click of a button, but I do want to give a little caution there. What I don't want to do is use AI to stop models from different backgrounds from being able to get jobs. So we don't want to take away jobs from anybody. So being aware of that. But I do think it could be a way to kind of bridge the gap for people who wouldn't have a budget otherwise, or until those resources become more widely available. So definitely thinking about it. I'm going to show some examples here using DALL-E because it's freely available. Even if you're using an older version, you can still use DALL-E some for free. Programs like Midjourney are a little bit better, but you have to, they cost money. And with Midjourney, you really have to know how to tell it what to do in your prompt. So if you aren't into art or photography and don't know the language to use to create the images, it's going to be a little bit harder. DALL-E is a little bit easier. So this is an example. I asked it to create a photo of a 10-year-old African-American boy wearing a correctly fitted bicycle helmet. I'm going to zoom in a little bit here so you can see him a little bit better. But if you look, quick glance, they're getting pretty close. The helmet fit isn't exactly right on the two on the right, but it's pretty close on the left. And the straps aren't exactly right, but they're pretty close. And they actually look like real kids and better than the Biden image that I showed you. This was an image that was created just even more recently than those two, because I'm trying to track and see how it's improving. And this one is, you know, even better. It looks like the strap's right, the helmet's down. You can see it goes on either side of the ear. It's looking pretty good. And this was done with the free version. But if you've noticed, they're zoomed in and it's just one person. And warning, what you're about to see is a little scary looking. I asked it to do the same thing with families. I just said family. I didn't give it any other guidelines on that, but riding bicycles, wearing their bicycle helmets. And as you can see, this does not work so well. If you look closely, the faces are all messed up. There's three legs in some cases. Can't even see the hands. The handlebars aren't right. So it can't do complex imagery just quite yet. Another way you can maybe get around some of this is they have cartoon versions. So some of the cartoon versions are pretty good. So if you haven't played around with this, I definitely would recommend taking a look at that. Just wanted to show this. This is a more realistic example, and this was shown in the New York Times. And on first glance, one of these was AI created and one of them is real. If you didn't know that one of them was AI created, would you be able to tell? And can you guess which one it is? It's hard. I had to really look at it and really think about it. Yes, Emma, good job. It is the one on the right. It was created using Midjourney. And here's the prompt in case you're interested. But it, yes, that. So Emma pointed out that it looks too good. And that is one way that you can tell sometimes. But if you didn't know that was AI generated and you're just looking quickly, you could be fooled by that. So interesting stuff, I think. Things we need to be aware of. Another thing I wanted to show is videos that are created. We actually use a platform called Vion Go. It's called Vion, and Vion Go is their version of incorporating AI. And it, I'm telling you, is staggering. Now, Vion has a cost with it. So it is not a free program, but it creates those cartoon images, videos, or the whiteboard images. Vion Go, you can actually type a prompt in it. Like you can see here, it says, make me a 3-minute long training video that involves two people having a conversation. It takes a little bit longer for it to do it, but you can definitely have it come out. And it's like 5 to 10 minutes, it'll create a 3-minute long video. And we did it recently and I was blown away by how good it is. If you pay a little bit extra for the next level up, it can actually translate the video in up to 70 different languages. And that includes dialects of languages. And the translated voice actually sounds like a native speaker. I tested it out with a 1-minute video, and in less than a minute, it translated everything, including the text that appeared on the screen, into that language. Now, they say straight from the beginning, do not trust that everything is accurate. They want you to go and make sure you have a native speaker look to make sure. With healthcare, that is even more important. We need to make sure we're saying things in the way they are said in that language in healthcare. But if you think about it, if you have a limited budget and your choices are 1, get everything from scratch translated, or 2, give them a text that's already done and just ask them to review it, it's going to take them a lot less time and cost you less money to just review. I'm going to play just a little bit of this clip so you can just see what it looks like.
Many doctors, including myself, advise against because of safety concerns. Many kids love jumping on trampolines, but did you know that they can be quite dangerous? Trampoline injuries are on the rise and can include broken bones, sprains, and even head injuries. That's why many doctors, there are certain activities that make...
So, video's longer. I just want to kind of give you a feel. This was created using the AI video. And again, it's not perfect. You know, you can see the kid on the ground kind of making funny movements, but because it's a cartoon, you can get away with some other things. We have used it and we found we couldn't use the video exactly as it was. We needed to edit it. But again, it was editing time versus starting from scratch time. And there's pretty impressive stuff you can do with it. Okay, so what's next? WHO is already using it to, they've created Florence, who is a virtual health worker who uses AI to dispel myths about COVID and smoking. It helps people develop a personalized plan to quit tobacco. We're starting to see big ideas in the healthcare space, things like driverless ambulances. So there's no need for space to the space for a driver. So we can fit in more medical equipment in emergencies. And then we can also have the ambulance will feed you information. For instance, if they're going to help victims of a car crash, it will look at car crash data that we already know now, and it will feed information about the details of the crash. And by the time they get to the site, the EMTs will know which occupants of the car are most likely to need medical care or be in critical condition before they even get there. This is an image from Volkswagen, and they are claiming that they will have this as, they have a goal to make this happen by 2025. So not long distant, like pretty soon this could happen. This is an example of an organization that is working with assisted living facilities on the right-hand side. They are starting to build AI tech that will go in the living areas that can track things like resident falls. It will even be able to track things like changes in the number of times the residents are getting up at night to go to the bathroom, which might indicate a change in medical status that without these programs, you know, this man might not tell his doctor because he might not think it's a thing, you know, until it becomes a real serious issue, where if the AI notices it, we can find things weeks, maybe months in advance that it can analyze. It can also be used for disease identification, analyzing medical images, accelerating drug discovery, optimizing healthcare operations, creating chatbots and virtual assistants that can provide immediate and personalized healthcare information. And I've heard presentations from Epic, which is a program that is already in many healthcare institutions, and working with programs like MyChart, the things they are going to be able to do using AI, mind-blowing, going to change the way we operate. Really exciting stuff on the horizon. I mentioned earlier that customized GPTs are now available. Already there's over 1,000 GPTs just for research, and more than 22,000 last time I looked customized GPTs. This is an example of just one GPT that was created by a high schooler using research from one particular research lab. It was trained on the research papers and transcripts of talks from the people from the lab. And they've made it available free on the web. So you can access it. You can ask it questions about research coming from the lab. And it's more up to date than 2021. So I'm just going to kind of have that playing, but you can see it's called Levinbot. And you can ask it questions and it will respond based on the research just from that lab, which means it's more up to date, like I said, than 2021, and it has specialized knowledge on research from that lab. So pretty cool example of how you can use it. And I can think of lots of different ways we might be able to use that. The other neat thing about these is you can, in theory, keep your data private. You can ask it not to be shared with builders, and you can choose if the user chats can be used to train the main GPT. You can even have internal only GPTs. So there's some interesting things that you can do by building your own. I have not built my own yet, so limited there, but you know, kind of exciting possibilities there. I wanted to show this because I wanted to kind of point out humans are still needed. I love this picture of iRobots, which are, you know, computers that vacuum, and there's a person in front sweeping up the floor in this store, right? ChatGPT and other LLMs and AI programs still need humans to do the cleanup. In the same way this iRobot employee is using their skills to supplement the technology, we also have to do that and use our own experience and judgment when using AI solutions. It's a powerful tool that can be used, but we have to use it with human intelligence and expertise for the best results. And I want to end with a quote, two quotes actually, that I heard at an AI summit that were leaders in the field who are creating the AI programs. And so one of them said, it's no longer if or when you should adopt AI, but what you should adopt. And this kind of goes along with a quote that I like: if you don't like change, you're going to like irrelevance even less. The computationally intensive tasks are going to be done by AI. So how are we going to adapt and how are we going to benefit from that? I'm going to challenge you after this talk. What are you going to do to learn more about AI? The other one is, and this is the fear, right? There's a lot of people who are saying AI are going to replace us. This guy said, AI is not going to directly replace humans. It is going to be the humans that use AI that will replace you. So which of those are you going to be? If you're not familiar with this space, you don't have to learn it all at once, but I do encourage you to start spending an hour a week learning about AI, playing with the programs, thinking about how it can help your work, what you want the next step to be, how you're going to be involved in the decision-making. I just joined an AI committee at our institution, and even in one meeting, I got a big company that's designing personalized AI programs for healthcare institutions to start thinking about health literacy, which they had not even considered before, which was kind of mind-blowing to me. So they're not thinking from that perspective, they're thinking of the tech perspective. We need to have the patient voice and the health communication voice and the actual public health voice. If you want some more information, CIRTC.org has artificial intelligence page. That's a good primer of kind of where to start with some things. There's a QR code here, and I think Shelley has access to these slides if you would like them. And then you can always reach out to me as well. And that's it.
Tracy, thank you so much for this incredibly helpful and timely information. We do have some time for a few questions if anyone wants to ask Tracy about anything. Please do raise your hand, or if no one is speaking, you can just go ahead and come off mute. Shelley.
I actually wanted to allow time for others to ask questions to Tracy, but just before you got on, I was telling Ingrid and Emma that I had tried to, or I'd asked ChatGPT, and I just have the free version app on my phone, and I just said, I need to create a catchy title for a workshop on advocacy without the word advocacy in it. And something, you know, it pops up and it's catchy. It's all the things that I was looking for. And my question, I think you already sort of answered this in your presentation. I feel the need when I send out the agenda to asterisk it at the bottom and say, title created with ChatGPT or whatever.
Yeah, different. So this is where we're in an interesting space, right? There's no real set guidelines yet. I tried to point out verbally and on the screen, I am trying to note when I use it, right? But not everybody's doing that. There are programs that are starting to be put in place that you can run through and see if you think it was AI generated, but those aren't perfect. And we're also seeing a lot of cases where it's saying it was AI generated and it actually wasn't. So I do like to do it. It will be up to you and your organizations. I will say I've also been looking at policies around this for institutions. My own institution, so I work at a children's hospital, December of 2022 told us you are not allowed to use any AI programs without prior approval. They shut all of it down. Now we're a hospital. It makes sense. We have to be really cautious. So be aware of whether or not your institution has one. But some of those will have some of that in there. And if you're going to use it, you should be aware of it. But Emma even pointed out, I noticed earlier in the chat, Zoom has a link in there that you can use things. I'm starting to see some of the Microsoft products now are integrating it, and you can use it to record Zoom Teams meetings, things like that. And it will actually create a transcript for you and create meeting agendas for you. My institution will not allow us to use that and has shut it down, but just be aware it could be trained on that. So if you're having conversations about proprietary information or grants that have novel information, you got to be careful about using some of those, and just kind of being aware about that. But yeah, it's starting to become more ubiquitous, but also good things, right? I talked to a colleague who told me over the holidays, her organization put out applied for 10 times more grants last year than the previous year using ChatGPT because they used it to generate drafts and then got feedback from there. So kind of crazy, 10 times more. What could we all do with even half of the money from that, right?
Or the time that it takes to write the grants.
Exactly. Again, don't put anything in there that's a brand new idea that you don't want shared with somebody else, though. So be cautious about that part of it. It's also not really good. I showed examples of asking it to do an eighth grade reading level. It doesn't understand how to do that exactly. It makes it sound less formal. But if you actually run it through the programs, it might not actually be eighth grade. Or like I've seen people use it for grants where it says, you know, make this into 500 words. It doesn't know how to do that actually. So you have to be really cautious about that kind of thing, but it can get you closer.
Thanks, Tracy. Any other questions? We've got a couple more minutes.
Usually when I give this talk, people are overwhelmed with thinking about what they didn't know about before. So definitely feel free to reach out to me if you have any other questions after this.
And also, as Shelley mentioned in the chat, the presentation is going to be sent out as soon as it's available. I'm assuming through the listserv that all of you heard about this meeting through. Leah, go ahead with your question.
Yeah, hi. Thank you so much, Tracy. This was super informative. And one of the things that I've been thinking about or like kind of seeing come across, you know, social media is the ethical concern around water usage, like how much it takes to like cool servers. I'm just curious what you know about that. I feel like I've only seen like headlines.
Yeah. So I didn't have a ton of time for that discussion in here, but I'm really glad you asked. So it's not only water, but it's the cobalt used to create the computers, it's the space, the warehousing and the amount of computers needed to create and run and train these programs is staggering. Some of them are literally city size networks. And so there is fear of things like, you know, remember when Texas had the snowstorm and it knocked out all of the power. The more of these cities that we're creating using these resources are scary. And it is something that we should be aware of. The training is another piece I didn't get to talk about, but some of the training, some of the training that happens once they're created, there's some researches that come out. One of the things they do is they want to make sure that it's not putting out the content that is really scary or shows things like, you know, child maltreatment or, you know, really bad, scary stuff. And so they hire low-cost workers from countries like India who spend, you know, their entire shifts day after day after day screening out scary content that is found from the web. And it is now causing problems, mental problems, and leading to more suicide for some of our trainees and things like that. So there are a lot of ethical concerns around these programs, even thinking about what they were trained on. There, you know, we don't know always because they're proprietary, but there is some concern that some of the information that was used to train is not information that we would want it to be trained on. Great question.
Yeah, and Marianne Contreras did add a comment and a question in the chat, saying that it's fascinating, and also she's curious to learn what the return was on the grant submissions that used the AI. Were the awards increased? Do you happen to know anything about the results?
So as of when I talked to her, they had not heard back on the grants yet, so I don't know the answer to that, but I am trying to pay attention to that for sure. I would have to imagine even just applying for more, you're going to be more likely to get them, but also that's going to be how you use it, right? They didn't just have ChatGPT create everything. They always had that human in the loop. So you got to make it your own as well. Because if you're just using ChatGPT, you're only using, it's only creating things that have already been done, which we know grants want novel information, right?
Thanks. And Tracy did mention that she is willing to respond to questions later. So if you need just some processing time or whatever, just make sure you go back to the recording and you know, get back in touch with Tracy. So I think I don't see any more questions. So again, thank you, Tracy. This has been incredibly informative, and I really appreciate that you've given us some places to start where we can all start learning more about different aspects of it. Definitely appreciate those.
Yeah,
so we're gonna
thanks for having me.
Absolutely appreciate all your time with us. So we wanted to spend the last few minutes of this meeting letting you know about some upcoming events and the network is planned, and we do have some virtual coffee chats that are coming up. We have three scheduled for this year. These are really informal. They are open to anyone in the network, and it's just an opportunity to talk about different topics. So AI was one of the topics of a coffee chat last year, and there was just so much interest. It's one of the things that sparked us asking Tracy to come join us today. So these are just really amazing opportunities to get to know some of your colleagues in other states. Next slide. So we also have our annual meeting, which is an in-person meeting that's coming up. It will be in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. It's going to be on April 17th and 18th. And it's going to be right after the end of the SAVER conference. If any of you are attending that, this is going to be a nice opportunity to save on resources for travel if you are going to SAVER. SAVER is the Society for the Advancement of Violence and Injury Research. Not that you have to be at that conference, but it does provide a little bit of help with travel in that sense. That you don't have to go to pay for two. There are going to be more details to come. There is the save the date that is already out there. It's going to be recirculated again. And as soon as we have more details about the agenda, we will certainly send that to you. Next up, we also have the Safe States annual meeting that's going to be held in Portland. It's going to be August 20th to the 22nd, and there are lots of opportunities to participate in that. The network will send out information about abstract applications that once they are out, that you can submit some of your ideas for presentations when those are released. And we just really wanted to thank you for being here today. You did give us some of your time and appreciate all that you do in the work that you're doing. If you do have any feedback or any questions or a follow-up that you have from this meeting, please feel free to contact any of us on the leadership team or Shelley Stephens-Stidham, whose email is on the screen right now. As we mentioned earlier, Shelley is with Safe States and does provide a lot of support to this group. There's also a link to an AI page that Tracy just posted in the chat, as well as her email address. If you do have some follow-up that you would like to, follow-up discussions that you would like to have with Tracy. And with that, we really appreciate it again that you joined us and look forward to seeing you again at our next event, which would be our February 22nd coffee chat. Thanks so much, y'all. Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks.